depression, it will truly bless you. I'm in the book of Judges, the 11th chapter. Judges chapter 11. Now Jephthah, the Gileadite, was a valiant warrior, but he was the son of a harlot, and Gilead was the father of Jephthah. Gilead's wife bore him sons, and when his wife's sons grew up, they drove Jephthah out and said to him, "You shall not have an inheritance of our father's house, for you are the son of another woman." So Jephthah fled from his brothers and lived in the land of Tob. And worthless fellows gathered around themselves about Jephthah, and they went out with him. And it came about after a while that the sons of Ammon fought against Israel. When the sons of Ammon fought against Israel, the elders of Gilead went to Jephthah from the land of Tob. And they said to Jephthah, "Come out, be our chief, that we may fight against the sons of Ammon." Then Jephthah said to the elders of Gilead, "Did you not hate me? Did you not drive me from my father's house? So why have you come to me now when you're in trouble?" The elders of Gilead said to Jephthah, "For this reason we've now returned to you, that you may go with us and fight with the sons of Ammon and become head over all the inhabitants of Gilead." So Jephthah said to the elders of Gilead, "If you take me back to fight against the sons of Ammon, and the Lord gives them up to me, will I be your head?" And the elders of Gilead said to Jephthah, "The Lord is witness between us. Surely we will do as you have said." Then Jephthah went with the elders of Gilead, and the people made him head and chief over them. And Jephthah spoke all these words before the Lord at Mizpah. Father, Lord, I'm already amazed at what's happened in this house. Amen. Not at what happened to us, but how we were able to touch you. God, I love it when worship is not about us, but it's about you. I love it when we become unselfish and we just pour our praise on you. I thank you, God, that you are a God that hears the prayers of your people. I pray now, God, that in this atmosphere, you'd help us to focus on you. Help us to hear the word that you have prepared. And I pray, God, that you'd set us free. In Jesus' name, amen. Today, I want to look at the ninth judge of Israel, Jephthah. Jephthah has a very interesting story. It's hard not to admire him, and it's kind of hard not to relate to him. Jephthah had a bad start to life. He's the son of Gilead. The first sentence of chapter 11 states that Jephthah was a valiant warrior. He was a man full of courage, full of bravery. He's skillful. He's a fighter. He's a survivor. We'll also learn that he's a great negotiator. Valiant. Oh my goodness. What an awesome description for a man or for a woman. It's a great way to start your storyline. But then there's another word that throws a twist into the story. He's a valiant warrior, but. Everybody shout, but. Oh, there's often a but that follows a compliment. In the South, we use the word, bless his heart. Don't we wish people would just stop at the compliment instead of going, well, bless his heart. And then follow the sentence. Don't you wish we could just end the sentence where the good part and no bless your heart parts? Because we know as soon as there's a but or a bless his heart, there's going to be something negative said that's going to shift the focus off of my positive and now onto my negative side. Jephthah was a valiant warrior. Stop there. Don't say anything else. He's an awesome man, fighting, brave. Isn't that enough? Isn't it satisfaction enough to end there? However, if you end with Jephthah was a valiant soldier, you miss his testimony. If you end with he was a valiant servant and you miss the word but, you will miss what he's been through. So sometimes in your life, you've got to have the but. You've got to have the bless his heart, because that now gives you the platform to testify of the hell you've been through, but you still made it. So it says in verse number one, he was a valiant warrior, but he was the son of a prostitute. He had a night of his dad, had a night of weakness, a night where he lost control, a night where he made mistakes. Up to that point, it seemed to be okay. When he was a little boy, Jephthah, everything was going up. Everything was going fine. Everything seemed to be happy. He was handsome. He was strong. He was brave. Maybe he's going to overcome the roots of his family tree. Oh, it looks like everything's going to be well in the family. Japheth's wife began to have sons. And those sons began to grow up and began to realize that Japheth was not from their mama, but from a prostitute. And they began to resent him, and they began to realize that this valiant warrior was from another woman, a harlot. And they began to realize, and I can only imagine how they bullied him, how they pushed him around, how they tried to fight him. Oh, you don't belong here, Japheth. You're an illegitimate son. You can't have part of our heritage. I can only imagine as they got older, things got worse and worse and worse. And before long, the sons of Japheth drove him out of their camp. They didn't want the son of a prostitute to be living in their house. They didn't want the sin of their father to be a constant reminder before their eyes of a night of weakness he had. So they ran him out. The roots of Japheth were contaminated. They were no longer, he was no longer wanted in the family. His brothers believed he didn't deserve to be blessed by their father. He didn't deserve to have the inheritance. So they forced him to leave. Some of you this morning may know exactly what it is to be forced to run away from a problem, forced to run away from an issue. Maybe you're a product of a bad decision and a night of mistakes. Maybe your life has got scars of some mistakes you've made, and no matter how hard you try to fit in, you're always reminded that the roots of your tree are contaminated. The sad thing is, Japheth had no control on how he was born. He had no control that his father slept with a harlot. And later, 9 months later, he's birthed, and now his life is haunted because of a bad decision of a father. It was a stigma he could not hide from. However, I believe that in this stigma, he learned to become a skillful warrior. Because he'd been fighting his whole life. Because his brothers had been bullying him his whole life, if you let me take some liberty. He had been in schoolyard fights from the beginning. I can only imagine the names he must have been called, the your mama jokes he must have had to endure. Can you only imagine the son of this prostitute, how he was disgraced and discriminated against his entire life? So he had to learn to survive by fighting. The only way he lived was to fight. His brothers wanted it out, didn't want him in their sight. They refused to share the inheritance with the son of a prostitute, so he left. He has bad roots. He's unwanted. He's disconnected. And now to top it off, he's the leader of a gang. Verse 3 says, a group of worthless fellows followed him and left with him. Sounds like a gang to me. Not how my group wants to be remembered in the Bible, a group of worthless men. But didn't we all, and don't we all at some point, gather a group of people around us who will accept us and recognize our strengths? Because we all have a basic need to be accepted. So if that means I can become a leader of a worthless tribe of men, so be it. At least they see me for who I am. At least they love me, even though I'm the son of a prostitute. Oh, even though I'm a bad mistake made in the middle of some off night in the middle of the alleyway somewhere, at least they love me. Some of y'all have been surrounded by worthless people. These men may have been worthless to everyone else, but to him they were everything. Because to Japheth they were his support, they were his encouragement. He knew they had his back. But I want to pause in this story just long enough to warn you of the dangers. I want to warn you of the dangers of allowing just anybody to be your support system. Just because they seem to have your back does not mean it's the right group of people for you. You be careful how you link to people that have no value. You be careful who you surround yourself with. You need to recognize that you have a need to be accepted, but don't allow yourself to be plugged into people who may cause you more harm than they do good. Be careful who your group of worthless people are. Look at the rap sheet of Japheth. He's got bad roots. He's unwanted. He's disconnected. He's in a gang. But he's a powerful warrior. He was a fearless man, and I believe he learned to survive on the streets. He learned to live off the land. He learned to sleep with one eye open. He'd been mocked. He'd been ridiculed. He'd been bullied by his family. His family tree roots were all messed up. But all of the conditions of his life created a man that was fearless. He was created to be a warrior. He was created to be strong and courageous. He had to learn how to fight because he had to survive on the streets. He'd become a skillful warrior because he had lived in conditions that made him a skillful warrior. He lived in conditions that made him have to fight. He'd been through a lot of hard days, a lot of long nights, and as a result, he became tough. As a result of his condition, stay with me, he became a warrior. God didn't toss him out because he'd been toughened up. Listen to me, God didn't get rid of him because he had to learn to survive on the streets. God knew that he could use this tough man to accomplish great things. He knew there was a job that a man that had fought his whole life, a man that had faced danger, a man that had faced shame and ridicule all his life, there was a job that Japheth could accomplish. A man who became street smart. This was a man God could take out of the wilderness with a worthless gang of men and set him up into a position of power. Yes. Japheth was fearless because of what he went through. Because he was abused. Because he was ridiculed. Because he was the son of a harlot. He got strong. And God knew that he had a strength God could tap into. Let me declare this. God does not despise you because of your past. God does not despise you because of your past, but he will take your past and use it for his glory. I know you got a messed up, checkered past. Don't let the devil destroy your future because of your messed up past, because the root of your trees are so contaminated, because of the filth you've been through, because of the poison you've allowed into your life. God doesn't despise you because of your past. He's going to use your past to bring glory to his life. God sees that you've been developed as a warrior. You've developed into a survivor. You've developed into a thick-skinned fighter. And God wants to take that person and use him for his glory. Just because you have bad roots does not mean you are disqualified from God's service. As a matter of fact, God may use your tragedy for his triumph. The story begins in verse 5. The sons of Ammon come to fight. And all of a sudden, Japheth's brothers go, uh-oh. Where's the fighter? We don't know how to fight. Where's Japheth? He's fought. They begin to realize, wait a second, he's been the man that defended their honor. He's been the man that protected them. He's been the man that stood up when everybody else ran away. He's been the man that stood up to the bullies. He's been the man that told the naysayers to leave. He's been the watchdog of their house, and all of a sudden, he's not there. Uh-oh, we ran away the wrong man. They need him now. All of a sudden, they want this son of a prostitute at their house. So they go back and they beg Japheth, hey, will you come home? We need you now because we got some problems with the Ammonites and they about to beat us down and we don't know how to fight. We love you, Japheth. We appreciate you, Japheth. Ben, just follow me or don't follow me. I see some of y'all are cold now, so I'm going to turn this back up, Matt. You still sweating back there? I'm going to turn it up just one notch. Amy usually controls the air. I felt sorry for Mandy. Matt's got sweat dripping from his brow, and Mandy's wrapped up in a mink coat. All in the same building. So listen, isn't it interesting that these same guys that despised him now recognize their need for him? Amen. Just stay with me. Japheth says, now, hey, ho, 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 aren't you the same guys that hated me? What you mean you want me now? Aren't you the same family members that cursed me? Aren't you the same people that told me I was worthless and I didn't deserve any? You want me now? Aren't you the people? Listen, some of y'all got those people in your life. They done tossed you aside, cursed you, rained you down. But when they bump into cancer, guess who they call it? They used to mock your worship. Now they need you to worship for them. They used to mock your prayer. Now they're needing you to pray for them. They said, yes, sir, that's us, brother. That's us. But we need you. We need you to fight. Don't you know Jephthah had to feel a little good? Don't you know he probably puffed up his chest a little bit, looked at his worthless warriors of a gang and says, looks like I'm going back to be important. But watch this. What does he do? He learned to negotiate. You see, sometimes in your life, you learn how to be a fighter. You learn how to be a survivor. You get thick skin. But you also learn how to negotiate. Because sometimes you learn on the streets it's better to talk your way out of a fight than to fight. Now, I ain't never lived on the streets, but I sound like it, don't I? Matt, the only little fight I remember was in first grade, and Cecil was about to jump on top of me and beat me down. And I was getting ready for Cecil's skinny little bony fist to hit me in the face. And I just braced myself knowing I was about to get a busted nose. And all of a sudden, something grabbed Cecil and took him off me. I thought it was the Holy Ghost, but I didn't know no such thing as those times. But I did have a brother that was in the fifth grade. And when he saw me on the ground, out of nowhere, my brother grabbed Cecil, stood him on his feet and said, if you lay one hand on my brother, you will have to deal with me. There was another time my brother stood up for me. Eric was calling one of my girlfriends, trying to win her love away from me. And my brother got on the phone and told Eric, you mess with my brother's girlfriend and you're going to mess with me. Only two times my brother and I ever got along, but praise the Lord for those two times. Praise God for those two times. I guess to make a point out of what I just said is, don't you realize when you're down on your back, Jesus will come to your rescue every time. When somebody's trying to steal away your love, you got a brother that's going to come up behind you and say, you better take your hands off that child. Japheth negotiated a deal. He says, I'll come back and fight for you, but you're going to make me ruler. I'm going to come back, but if I come back and I bring you victory, you're going to place me at the highest seat of honor. When you've been tossed aside, listen to me, some of this is going to bring you hope. You've been tossed aside, abused, neglected, but you learned to survive and you didn't give up. You didn't quit. You didn't commit suicide. You didn't throw in the towel. You didn't hide in a cave somewhere. Oh, yes, surely you surrounded yourself with some worthless men and maybe you did some things you shouldn't do, but you learned how to keep on going. And because of that, God will restore you to a place greater than what you left. He'll give you not only a seat at the table, he'll give you the seat at the head of the table, because there's something inside of you God's not giving up on. There's a skill inside of you. God can use you. I don't care what you've been through, there's still something inside of you. I love it when God restores the less fortunate to the fortunate seat. Salvation in Jesus makes all things new. He takes you out of the gutter and sets you into a better seat of honor. Jesus doesn't leave you in your sins. He doesn't leave you in the gang of worthless men. He brings you back to the Father's house. Jesus doesn't leave you in the pig pen and with the clothes that smell like pig manure. But rather, when you come to Jesus, he takes off that garment stained with sin and he gives you a garment of salvation, a robe of praise. He takes away your mourning for the joy. He fills you with the power of the Holy Ghost, with the power to lay hands on the sick and cast out devils. God cleanses you from all your filth, but he'll use your experience to bring victory to the people around you. Oh, Brother Chris, I'll never do anything for God. Look at my life. Look at it. You're still breathing.
You're still here. But people would just be they'd blush at all my sins. Let them blush, baby, because you went through that. There's something now. There's something inside of you, deep in the root of your life, that can do something greater than anybody else around you. And there's a group of people that need you, so they'll move you to the head of their table because they recognize you've been through hell on earth, but now there's a fighter inside of you. You know what it's like to be lost, but now you're found. You know what it's like to be blind, but now you see. You know what it's like to be in hell and now set free. You're not worthless because of your past. You're not worthless because of what you've been through. You're useful. He may have some bad roots, but Jesus wants you to produce good fruit. God doesn't see your past as a way to condemn you, but as a way to use you. Oh, yeah, you may have bad roots, but you can still produce good fruit. Japheth's brother came begging, and he negotiated his contract. He went to defend the land from the Ammonites. To make a long story short, because I know y'all are hungry, because this time change is telling me we should have already eaten by now. That's why you're hungry, because it's past your lunchtime on last Sunday's time. Crazy time. I woke up laying in the bed going, well, this time yesterday I was already up, but I ain't supposed to be up today because the time changed. So Japheth goes to the leaders of Ammon and says, all right, I'm using redneck language. I'm about to whoop your tail. Or you can sign a peace treaty with me. They didn't sign it, so he whooped them. He tried to negotiate with them. They must have not realized that this man who was the son of a harlot, the man that had to run away and be the leader of a gang of worthless men, had learned how to fight, learned how to survive. So Japheth went and conquered the land. The man with bad roots, the man with a checkered past, is now the man producing good fruit. The man that was despised, rejected, now not only is accepted, but he's honored. He's not only sitting at the family table, he's at the head. Can I tell you this morning, God can use you too. Yep, even though you've been discriminated against, even though you've been abused your whole life, even though you've been addicted. Listen, there's more than one person that suffered from addiction in this room. There's several of y'all that's been bound by narcotics and bound by alcohol and bound by all kind of stuff, all kind of addictions. But that doesn't mean God ain't gonna use you. No, but because of your addiction, because you've been through it, God shows you, you can be free from that mess, and now God can use you for his glory. Your family tree is less desirable than your neighbor's. Matter of fact, you try to put so much dirt on those roots so nobody ever find them, because you got a twisted family table. But God can use you because of that. Even though your family tree is more messed up than Japheth's, God has the ability to use you because of what you've been through. You have to be willing, though, to come back to him. Amen. You have to be willing. Listen, I don't know what time it is. 10 after. I got 5 minutes. I know you don't understand how you can come back. Japheth did not stay out with the worthless men. He had to come back to receive his honor. Some of you are hoping to receive your honor, but you're still out with the worthless men. You can't receive your honor until you come back to the place in Christ you're supposed to be. Amen. Well, I'm waiting on God to do everything right. I'm waiting on, no. God's waiting on you to come back. Amen. To that. Japheth had to come back before he was ever put in position, watch, to win the battle or to be the head of the house. Before he ever received his blessing, before he ever received his honor, before he ever received his inheritance, he had to come back from the worthless men. The Bible doesn't say whether the worthless men followed him back. I'm going to assume they probably did, but it doesn't say. But I got a feeling, just like David's mighty warriors that were surrounded him, I bet they came back and had the sharpest swords in the camp. But sometimes, for the moral of this story, you got to leave the worthless man because there's a position of honor that they're not qualified to get. Ooh, that was a quiet moment. Sometimes you have to leave the worthless men because you have an honor they're not worthy to have. All of those men that left with Japheth was not elevated to be the ninth judge of Israel. Only he was. Some of y'all are waiting for the group to do a certain thing, and what God's calling you to do is not for the group, it's for you. And you got to get into the place where God can use you and honor you and empower you. There's a place of honor. There's a place for a warrior. There's a place for the son or daughter of a prostitute. You've got to return. There's a place for a messed up past, an embarrassment past, somebody with some skinned up, bloodied up, scarred up knees. There's places for you. Amen. But you've got to come back to the kingdom. You've got to come back to God. Are you going to fight for the kingdom of darkness, or are you going to fight for the kingdom of God? Right. I want you to realize, Nikki, get ready. I want you to realize who you are this morning. I want you to wake up and know that God can use you in spite of what you've been through. Even with all your mistakes, with all your faults, with all your mess ups, God will take bad roots and produce good fruits. Let me close with one last sad fact about Japheth. The Bible says, in the spirit, the Lord came upon him. He defeated the Ammonites. And Japheth was full of zeal and excitement. And he made a vow to the Lord that said this: I will offer you the first thing that comes out of my house as a sacrifice. He comes riding up after victory. And his only child, a daughter, the only hope for heirs to be produced at this point of his life was through his daughter. And she was so happy to see him running, the dust coming out of his chariot wheels, that she ran out of the house to greet her father, who she loved. And Japheth had made a vow to sacrifice her to God. Japheth had learned one thing. He learned how to fight. He learned how to negotiate, but he also learned you got to keep your word. I would imagine there were times in his life that he had nothing else but his word, and he had to stand by it. Was the vow foolish? Yes. Was the vow unnecessary? Yes. You be careful with uncontrolled zeal, because it can produce unbearable grief. You be careful with excitement without control. You be careful not to allow the newfound energies to cause you to do foolish things. Summer, when I wrote this sermon on Thursday, you know what I said? God, I wish I didn't have to end with this part. Because I knew it was going to be a high, and then all of a sudden, boom, 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 we was going to run aground. Because it is so easy for us in what's going on in our church. And that's why I think it's important for you to be here on the Friday night prayer meetings, at the 9:15 prayer meetings, when we're all tapping in together. Because what you begin to realize is there is a momentum in our church, but we cannot let uncontrolled zeal cause us grief we cannot bear. In other words, work inside the confinements of the wisdom of God's word. Use wisdom before you make unnecessary vows. Can I tell you, it's time to stop allowing your past to keep you, stand with me, out of what God wants you to do. I know you're a fighter. I know you're a survivor. I know you got some things in your past you're ashamed of, some things you ain't never told nobody. I know you've surrounded your life with a group of worthless men, but God can still use you. God can still pull you. And listen, I want to remind you, he didn't go to just the table. He didn't just pull up one of the chairs. He went to the head of the table. Do you have bad roots in this room? Maybe bad roots, not just the parents that you were birthed to. However, Chris, you ain't got time to go here. There are generational curses that come from bad roots, but you have the ability to break those. You have the ability to put a stop to what the devil has done to everybody else connected to your family. You can be the first one to be free. You can be the first one not to be addicted. You can be the first one to walk in joy. You can be the first one to speak in tongues with the power of the Holy Ghost. You can be the first one to tap in. Oh, we were all raised Baptist. Hallelujah. Be the first one. My family was all raised Methodist. That's why I'm a little confined most of the time. You may have bad roots, but you can still have good fruits. God wants to turn what you've been through into a strength for His kingdom. Don't try to hide it. Don't try to cover it up. Just let God sanctify it so that He can use that street smart for His kingdom. The Bible says to be as wise as a serpent, but as harmless as a dove. In other words, you can use all the stuff you learned when you were, I got so many words coming out of me that I shouldn't say. I got a lot of street words flowing in my mouth. No, flowing in my brain. I'm choking them because I keep on seeing little kids in here. So I'm trying to use better terminology. Not nearly effective terminology, but better terminology. I know you've been around the block a few times. You've done some stuff. That doesn't disqualify you for the kingdom. Not when you come back to the Father's house. Because when you come back like the prodigal, He doesn't remember the pig pen. He only remembers you're His child. Oh, I promise you I'm stopping. I promise I'm stopping. He doesn't even consider that you were living in a pig pen. He puts a new ring on your finger, a new robe on your back. He prepares a fatted calf and a celebration occurs because even though you learn some junk on the streets, God's about to set you up because He knows you can produce good fruit. Father, I delivered a word that I know You gave me to preach. And Lord, I shall not apologize for the message that You've given me. But I pray, oh God, that You would use it now because there's people in our room that feel condemned, feel beat up because of how they were betrayed or because of how they were abused, because of the torment of their lives, because of the hell they've lived in on earth, because of what they've been through, God. They feel like they're not qualified as a child of God. But Lord, nothing is more untrue than that. They are qualified because of the blood, and You use what we've been through as a sanctified strength to help us proclaim the gospel. Take away those checkered paths, but let us not forget what we've gone through. Let us not come to church and become wimps, but let us use the same strength we used to have, but now use it for God. Oh, in Jesus' name. I'm going to invite people to the altar this morning. Maybe some of you need prayer. Maybe some of you feel like Japheth. You've been accused, you've been pushed away, you've been ridiculed, you've been tormented. Your brothers have tried to get rid of you because of who you came from. The devil's trying to make you feel like you'll never belong, you'll never fit in because your past is too horrible to be a church person. You must not know the people Jesus hung out with. You must not remember that the very first person He revealed Himself to was a woman that had a lot of men pass through her bedroom, but recognized her as a daughter. Even in His bloodline, there's a prostitute. No matter what your past is, He wants to make your future strong. There's other people that need to be in this church. If you don't know the Lord as your Savior, if you've not committed your life to Him, if you're backslidden, may I please invite you to come give Jesus your heart. Let Him wash away your sins. Let Him put a new robe on you. Do you smell like pigs? Come swap the robes. Come swap the robes. Do you smell like the harlot that you were birthed from? Come on, come swap your robes. But Brother Chris, you don't know what I've been doing. I don't care what you've been doing as long as you come and repent. Come. Whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.